Well, you have much to be thankful for this morning. One is that John had asked me if I would do the technology. And secondly, Lee Ron, after choir this morning, he went home and picked up the chain so that you could be wondering, why do we have a chain in equip? The reason we have a chain is that in Pakistan, they say that with a Muslim person, there's 100 links in the chain between the time when they're totally a Muslim to the time when they become a believer. And that link in the chain can be a Bible study. It can be a smile. It can be like Pastor Robert Jay said last week. He said that when for the youth service Wednesday evening, one of the high school girl came who was unfamiliar, and the other girls came and talked to her. And that's a link in the chain. And so we're going to be giving you many links in the chain. And you are links in the chain. You're links in with one another, in your prayers, in your giving. Your links in the chain that go on and on. And so Els is going to come now and share your links in the chain that happened in Wien, in Austria, with Don and Barb and Dick and Els.
And I wanted to give a sequel to John's presentation of the Steinkraus story in New Guinea. Do you remember that? That they were all deluged in a mudslide and the whole family went to be with the Lord. Just an amazing thing. But the wife of Steinkraus had a father who was very active here in church. His name was Art Schreers. And Art was just a plain old man. But he loved the Bible and he loved teaching it. And so Dick and I would sometimes go to his Bible studies. And I think it was after our first term there, so after we'd been in Austria for 5 years, we were ready to go back for the next 5 years. And Art came up to me with an envelope. He said, Els, I want to give this to you. And it was a huge check for a piano for me. And that piano is now in Pine Haven with me. We brought it back. But it was a wonderful gift. And the thing is, in Austria, everybody knows music. They know the musicians. They know the pieces that they've written. But they themselves have never performed or done anything. So, I mean, I just couldn't believe it, you know. Kids had never sung in a choir. Adults didn't know how to sing parts. And I was very eager to get a choir going. So every time we had a Bible study in our home or a men's meeting or something, afterwards I would say, hey, let's go through this one song and sing your parts. And that's how they learned it. And we ended up with a wonderful choir. So, I mean, it was just a wonderful gift that Art gave to me. Yeah. And I just thought that was an interesting thing. It was in 1965 when Dick and I set out for Austria. It was right after the Second World War. And we discovered that the people there were very difficult to reach for God. And why? There were so many widows. And they blamed God for taking their husbands and their sons in the war. And that they were alone. And how could God love them? And how could anybody have a relationship with God? It was really, really difficult. And it was actually the start of the evangelical movement, which, unbelievable, because Roman Catholicism was in the history of Austria for 700 years. The emperors were all Catholic. And so to be an Austrian was to be a Catholic. But all they did was get baptized into the church. They never had a relationship to the church. Many never went to church. So we found a very difficult place to minister. But the Lord did wonderful things, and especially with the younger people who were starting to ask questions. Why am I here? What is the purpose of my life, etc.? And we started Bible studies, and they came to know the Lord. So it was young people who actually started both of our churches, which are still going right now in Austria. That was such a wonderful thing that the Lord did. And all I can say is we were just plain old people who went to Austria, had to learn the language. It's a difficult language for one thing. If you've ever learned German, it's not an easy language to learn. And yet the Lord used us. It's amazing. And the Lord had a plan for that country. And that plan is going further. So praise the Lord for that. After we had our first church, which Don and Barb were very active in helping us with the first church, the mission sent them to further south to a town south of Vienna, and they sent us north to where the rich people lived, the doctors and the Indian chiefs. And there too, it was the university students that found us and who were spoken to and accepted the Lord. And we had a whole wonderful group of university students, but we were praying, Lord, how can we start a church with only students? They're all singles. We need families. And pretty soon they started marrying each other. And then we had lots of little children, and we started the children's group. The Lord has his plans. And it's just amazing how he works. But after, let's see, it was in 1999, when we should have come back home to retire, when Dick had a TIA, that's a small stroke, and it took away all of his executive abilities. So he couldn't plan, he couldn't organize. It was really difficult. We saw that he can't continue in his function as a missionary pastor. The Lord gave us a wonderful young couple who were looking for a place to do their senior year practical assignment, and they came to our church, and they loved our church, and they our church loved them. So when they went back for their senior year to finish up, then the church called them, and they came. And Martin said, Dick, this is my first church. I've never been a leader of a church. Could you stay a year and mentor me? So we stayed for a year to mentor them. And the Lord provided such a wonderful young couple to the church. And the church grew. And it was just great to see what the Lord was doing. It was without us. The Lord was doing it. And then after that year, he came from Germany. The grandparents said, we want you back in Germany, because they had four children while they were with us. And so they went back to Germany, and the Lord provided the next couple. And the next couple was an Austrian, a young Austrian, who came to America to study at the seminary out in Boston. Yes, Gordon Conwell. And he was just on fire for the Lord. And the Lord called him to our church. And he's still the pastor there. He's been there for 10 years now, doing a wonderful job. And just praising the Lord. I mean, the connection that we had with, his name is Ewald. That's E-W-A-L-D, so Ewald. Ewald was a student at the university when Philip studied at the university in Vienna. He realized after he graduated from Taylor that he could study at the University of Vienna for free. And so he took that opportunity and became involved in the student missions intervarsity. And Ewald was there, and they became best of friends. So isn't that how the Lord just yeah. brings things together? It's just amazing.
And Alice, let me just say, this week when we send out the video link, we will send a link to the pictures, and you'll see Ewald and his wife and some of the outreach ministries at the church. Look for that Monday, Tuesday. We'll send that out. Go ahead.
Okay, thank you. Yeah, I was hoping that we could have it on a big picture. Yeah.
Me too.
That would have a picture says 1,000 words, and I was hoping 1,000 words would come up. But anyway, just to see how the Lord had a plan, and we were able to fit in a little way there. But he's the one who's working. And the Lord has a plan for each one of us. Each one of us has contacts. And each one of us can be a chain and a link for someone. And that is the amazing thing, that the Lord uses us as a link, just a little old link. But he uses us, and we praise him for that. So that's my conclusion. He has a big plan, and we are an important link in his big plan. And just this last week, I read through part of Genesis, and there was one thing that the Lord just really spoke to me about, where Moses is implementing some of the feasts. And Moses said to the people, remember this day in which you came out from Egypt. Remember what the Lord has done in my life, in your life. Remember. And then the second thing he says is, keep this service in this month. So keep a remembrance, either a day or an occasion where you can remember what the Lord has said and done, and then tell your son on that day because of what the Lord has done for me. So the thing is, okay, remember, keep a day, a special remembrance, maybe a something that'll help you remember that thing, and then tell it to your family, to your grandchildren, to whoever. Tell what the Lord has done. And that is a very good instruction that the Lord gave to them, and I think also to us. We should tell what the Lord has done in our lives.
Thank you, Else, and thank you, Don and Barb. And thank all of you for your ministry in being through them. And Marlene and I, we have been in four different schools. We were in Zimbabwe. We were in Mavrodona Christian High School. We were in the Evangelical Bible College there. Then we went to Pakistan. We were at Murray Christian School. And then we were in the School for Teaching Afghan Refugees English as a Second Language. And Marlene's going to come and tell you about some of that links in the chain.
Well, Pastor John wrote us an email, and he said, tell us about your ministry through the years, God's call on your life, a challenge, and present state of missions in Pakistan. So that should take a long time, but I only have a short while. I'm going to start with God's call on my life. I was born in Sheboygan, and some of you may remember my parents, Henry and Cora Silvis. My dad was a plumber, and he had a business, and much of our life revolved around that business ever. However, my parents loved the Lord, and we were members of Fountain Park Methodist Church, which was on 9th and Erie, you know the church. In some way, my father met Pastor Mooney, and I he liked him so much that on Sunday mornings we would go to the Fountain Park, and on Sunday nights we would go to the Youth Center, which was the Evangelical Free Church on 9th and Spring. We heard many missionary speakers at that church, and I was so drawn to them. My mom would have some of the missionaries over for meals, and also at that time there was a youth center at the Evangelical Free Church. We had lots of young people there, and Dick was one of those young people, and he was such an enthusiastic Christian that many of us were influenced by him and also influenced to go to team mission. So my interest in missions continued through college, and after college I taught for a year, and then I decided if I was going to pursue missions I needed more training. So I enrolled at the mission program at Columbia Bible College in South Carolina, where I met Stu. He was already planning on being a missionary teacher in Rhodesia. I wasn't just quite sure where Rhodesia was. So I went to the library and looked it up. So after we were finished at Columbia Bible College, we were married and planned to leave for Africa, specifically Rhodesia, now called Zimbabwe. Oh, many of you might recall the name Cecil John Rhodes. He was a Britisher. He started the Rhodes Scholarship. And the name Rhodesia came from him. That's just a little tidbit of why Rhodesia was called Rhodesia. We were there studying language for 6 months, and then we were assigned to a mission school in the north of Rhodesia. It was really in the bush, but you know, it wasn't bad. I can't recall that we missed anything especially. We had a generator on the station. It was a boarding school, so we had about 200 black teenagers, and we were teaching them all subjects. We followed the British curriculum, and of course, we had chapel for them. We had Bible classes. We had evangelistic services. I remember one time we had a team from Taylor University come out, and it impressed the students so much. Anyway, each year some students were saved, and if you go to the Evangelical Church in Zimbabwe today, you will see some of our students there. But trouble came to that country. Shortly after we were there, the Africans revolted against the white government. The Africans went to China. Isn't that surprising? Some of the Africans, I'm saying, not all of them. And there they learned guerrilla warfare. And so they came back with weapons, rifles, and their plan was to attack schools and farms and many other things. So in 1972, six guerrillas with rifles surrounded our house and asked Stu to accompany them to the house of the boarding master and chaplain. These men were black and they were members of our staff at the school. While Stu watched, they killed the two men. And it's a long story, but as a result, the school was closed and we were moved to the city. And also during this time, we were there for 5 years, our two children were born. Okay, so as we moved to the city, we were involved in Bible college ministry and in teaching the white high school. In those days, the whites were in one school and the blacks were in another school. And the whites had an hour every week for Bible study. And so I participated in that ministry. We saw some results. Some girls came to the Lord, and one of them is in Texas right now. Anyway, we stayed in Zimbabwe until the blacks took over over the country, and Mugabe became the prime minister. You might remember his name. He was fine at first, but after a while he became very corrupt. And some people said, oh, he's the richest man in the world. Well, that was just a rumor. We don't really know. But anyway, the Zimbabweans suffered tremendously with food, and every part of the country went down. After we were at home then, our son Dan had some learning disabilities, and he couldn't go back to Zimbabwe. I can't explain the system that made it difficult. But anyway, team offered us a position at Murray Christian School in Pakistan. Stu would be a principal and I would be teaching. Murray was situated at 7,000 feet in the Himalaya Mountains, and the children were all came from maybe 20 or 30 different countries. Quite a change from Zimbabwe, you can't imagine. Okay, so we had many things to learn about Islam. We had many things to learn about Pakistan. It was a good time. After 9 years at Murray, we were assigned to the Afghan English Language School in the capital of Islamabad, which is the capital of Pakistan. It became our most fruitful and most enjoyable ministry. So we taught English by day, and often in the afternoons we would have Bible classes in our homes. And we couldn't speak about Christianity in the school. We had to, but everyone knew we were Christians. Everyone in that school knew we were Christians. And some were interested and would come to the Bible studies. There were so many Afghans in Pakistan because Russia actually had been settling Afghanistan. They settled in Afghanistan, shall we say. But then the Taliban came into Afghanistan. Well, Taliban are nothing but a radical Muslims. And so that's why we had so many Afghans in Pakistan. Okay, so I was teaching and Stu was teaching, and we, as I said, had the Bible studies, and you're supposed to now see pictures of of the students. But I'll tell you about one student who came to Christ through our Bible studies. His name was Shoaib Ibadi. He was a lawyer, and he accepted Christ. And eventually, he immigrated to Pakistan, to Canada, and he became the executive director of a mission group. And I just want to read you a little bit about what this mission group does. They broadcast Christian television programs across Afghanistan and beyond. They partner with satellite TV, and they reach the audience within Afghanistan and in the many Afghans who have gone to Europe, gone to Asia. And so the ministry is really worldwide. When we first came home from Pakistan, we kept in close contact with Afghan believers. Many who immigrated to Canada, and we have contact with now only a few of them, but we see the gospel is spreading through them. And I also became involved in a prison ministry, which closed during the COVID time, but now once again is flourishing, so we're thankful.
Now, let me backtrack just a little bit. She was mentioning Shoaib. His father-in-law was Asif Deen, And Asif Dean, they came to the ESL center, they learned English, and they invited us to our home, and we had kabuli palau, you know, big food, and he came to Bible studies. We were at a Easter program, and at the Easter program on a Sunday evening, it was Easter, and they were gathering around him afterwards and saying, you should commit to Jesus. And he said, a year ago, I was a Muslim. Now I'm one of you. And somewhere along in that year, the links of the chain fitted together, and he became a believer, and he worked at that. Okay, a little of my background. I was born at a very early age. I was out in New York State. From that time, I always went to church with my parents. They took me. We went to a Methodist church. And then they switched and went to a small independent church. And one night, the pastor was speaking on Romans and whether or not, if you died tonight, would you be in heaven? And I got home and felt, no, I wouldn't. And I couldn't sleep. And so I got down by my bed and asked the Lord to forgive my sin and come into my heart and to save me. And so I went on through high school. I went to college, Christian college, and didn't grow too much. I was a Christian, but you know, I was. And then after 2 years, I didn't know what I wanted to do. So I went in the Army for 3 years. And I was an instructor at Fort Belvoir, and part of I found a very good church. I found Army buddies there. One of my Army's buddy in the last year, he died. And we went to this church. They had a young adults group. It was military men. Young military men. We had the secretaries who were working for the government in Washington. They were, you know, we just had a wonderful group. The navigators were active there, and we did their topical memory system, and I learned many verses. When I left the Army, I felt I enjoy teaching, and I felt someday I'll be teaching on a mission field. And so, as Marlene said, we went to Columbia Bible College, and the rest is history. Okay, I'd like to tell you stories of people who have come out of the schools. Some of them, we have been links in their chain. Others, we haven't been, you know, we've been a very minor link, because a link sometimes may be a facilitator. You know, they didn't touch the person, but they set up the meeting. They set up the situation so that they could hear the gospel, so that they heard what was going on. And they're in the background, you know, they're doing nothing. But they're facilitators. And so when Marlene said, when we came back, we were in Toronto, and we had Afghan reunions there. In Toronto, we found there is a church, and the pastor of that church is Francis Mpindu. And he was one of our students at the Evangelical Bible College in Zimbabwe. And there he was over there now. And now he is the director in African Leadership and Reconciliation Ministries in Canada. So from that link in the chain, he's continued to make more links. Okay, let me tell you some others. John Mitchell. John Mitchell, his grandparents were missionaries in India. His parents were missionaries in Pakistan. He went to Murray Christian School. Now, Murray Christian School, we had, Marlene said, all of these people through many countries. The majority of them, it was for missionary children. And so we had missionary children from Germany, England, Australia, New Zealand, some Americans, etc.
Korea.
Yeah. And so one of them, John Mitchell, he has continued on. Now he is, you know, probably, what, 40, 50. He's up in there. But he was going to come back and be principal of Foreman Christian College. But the government would not give him a visa to come back to do that. And so he couldn't. So now he's going back on a tourist visa. He's meeting with the Pakistani young men leaders in the church and helping them to establish, well, here's what he says, that strengthen the ability of Pakistani Christian organizations to use digital marketing and web-based site strategies for more effective outreach. Secondly, to develop and initiate a national leadership development strategy for the Pakistani church. Third, to develop business skills and a biblical understanding of the marketplace among kingdom-minded Pakistani Christian entrepreneurs. And so he has continued on and is building it there. He says, the business skill initiative might strike you as odd. Christian leaders in Pakistan are asking how long the Pakistani church will be dependent upon Western resources to fulfill its mandate to God's instrument of transformation in the second largest Muslim country. They realize that the funds they rely on from Western churches, individuals, foundations, all come from wealth created in the marketplace. In Pakistan, the Hindus, the Baha'is, Farsi, etc., are all minorities, are prominent in business, giving them influence, respect, and resources. The Christians are unique in having no significant business presence. Wouldn't it be wonderful to generate a redemptive Christian entrepreneurs in Pakistan who understand that their giftings and the wealth they generate are entrusted to them by God to be stewards for His glory? Imagine what that would unleash. And so he's working in that. Another student through Murray Christian School, through many, many years ago, we were not there at that time, but his name is Jonathan Addleton. If you go on the website, you can Google Jonathan Addleton, and he is there. He was in the State Department for many years, and he was in South Africa. He was here, he was there. He became ambassador to Kandahar in Afghanistan. And he, after that, he went to, was ambassador of, in Mongolia with his wife and daughter there. All right, let me read this. He was ambassador to Mongolia, then to Kandahar in Pakistan, in Afghanistan. As ambassador, the following report was made. On April 6, 2013, Adelton was part of a group targeted by a suicide bomber as they walked to a local school to deliver textbooks in the Afghan city of Quetta. A suicide bomber's car exploded just outside the walls of the provincial reconstruction team Zabul, killing a Foreign Service officer, Anne Schmidlinghoff, three U.S. service members, and an Afghan interpreter. Jonathan Adelton had separated from the group and were walking, and he was laying in a ditch in some other area. And so an Army report of the incident noted that Adelton may have been the main target, although insurgents were perhaps targeting anyone partaking in the mission. Adelton later wrote, "Not a day goes by when I don't relive what happened on that cloudless morning, recalling every moment as it unfolded, reliving endlessly what might have been. I wish a dust storm had blown up out of nowhere, causing all flights to be canceled. I wish the outcome had been different. I wish I had been killed instead. But somehow I did survive alone among the living." And so he has been a believer all through his experiences and came out of Murray Christian School. Okay, let's go down under. In Australia, we have many people who have gone to Murray Christian School. One were Hawks. We worked with them. We had their kids in school. And I have pages here from their kids saying the influence of the school on their lives, the influence that has impacted them to this day in relating to the foreigners who are in Australia, in relating to different people. It's made a impact on them. And you know, they talk about what they're doing, etc. Well, they didn't say too much about where they were with the Lord. I wrote back, and their mother wrote this. She said, "Stu, I'm afraid they just thought of how Pakistan affected them in their growth. All three children are Christ followers and active in church. Lenore is one, the daughter, leading services, her husband preaching. Michael is lay preaching, and Emma is a wonderful prayer. She always was, and now has a fulfilling life with motherhood and nursing. All three are bringing up their children to love the Lord and have them in Christian schools. Lenore teaches in a Christian school. After Pakistan, Gary, her husband, went back to Bible college with a view to returning to the field." And so that's Australia, down under. Okay, let's go out to Madison. In Madison, there's a man living there, Ed Brown. At one time in his life, he was 5 years old. You may find that difficult to believe. But he was a missionary kid with the Baptist mission. His parents, or his mother, I think his father was away. They were having a picnic down in the Punjab by a canal. And he was floating his boat on the canal, you know, having fun with it. And then they looked up and the little boy was not there. And so one of the men ran, jumped into the canal, muddy water, you can't see in it, you know. And he jumped in, he went up, down, came up, till his feet hit little boy. And he's able to get little boy and bring him out. And his mother had just finished, she was a nurse, had just finished a course in how to resuscitate someone who was drowning. And so that all fit together. Okay, so at this time, he is a Lusant catalyst for creation care. He is a director and CEO of Care Creation, guiding its work in the U.S., Kenya, and Tanzania. Ed has been involved in creation care for almost 20 years. He says, what does the environment crisis have to do with the Great Commission? What does climate change have to do with Christian faith? For more than a decade, Ed Brown, a leader in the evangelical creation care movement, has been helping Christians grapple with these questions. Our Father's World, now updated, reissued, is his bold passion. Okay, there's over in Scotland a family called Murray's. She was my secretary. He taught at Murray Christian School. They had three children there. And on their children, he said, their daughter Karen is a midwife in the States and involved in pastoral ministry and bell ringing in her church. Their son Gavin Murray is a civil engineer and a technical person, etc., in his church. And Malcolm Murray is a counselor and involved in his church outreach in the south of England. And so there it has gone on. Now, another is David Davis. You may remember that David Davis was speaker at our missions conference here in 2007. You have good memories. Okay, he was in the first graduate class of Murray Christian School way back when. And he became a missionary, became field chairman, and then he was in the Wheaton Home Office, and he was here in 2007. He's retired now. He's with his son Jonathan Mitchell, who are in Uganda, and they are involved in the Ideas Workshop that is giving a ministry that is giving hope and changing lives through discipleship, vocational training, and business. The Davises mentor and disciple Ugandan youth, specifically young men between the ages of 18 and 30, who do not have the opportunity to attend university. Many young people in Uganda do not have godly role models or hope for their future. When we put a tool in a young man's hand and engage him with the Word of God, a transformation takes place. His problems don't go away, but he sees them differently. He has hope. And so that's happening out in Uganda. You know, a link way back to Murray Christian School and going on through the time. All right. I have one from down under. Grant Locke. Grant and Jana Locke. And he had a twin brother. And Barry. Grant and Jana were missionaries out. Their children were in Murray Christian School. And he was on the board. One day he, you know, we needed a boarding parent. And one day he said, I think that you should talk to my brother back in Australia. And they had been on a farm where they were raising stud bulls for the market. And so we contacted his brother Barry, and his brother came for boarding department, and then he became boarding master, etc. All right. So Grant is writing. He said, regarding Murray Christian School and our kids and their families are in no special ministries. Okay, they're not preachers, they're not what. But I think that MCS was a big part of the journey of growing in handling challenges, growing in good values, the kind of values that work. Murray Christian School helped them grow as individuals while giving them support in growing in responsibility, teamwork, and concern for others rather than just self. Now, while I say they are not in special ministries, he says, in fact, they are. They care for their families. They have stable role modeling marriages, train their children, their kids in leadership and responsibility, in school, church, overseas care and support, and input into the community. I'm very proud of them all, our kids and their spouses. All six were Murray Christian School students, and our seven grandsons, which were not in Pakistan. We are so thankful for those who the Lord has called to be teachers, house parents, administrators, etc. If the Lord is calling you to be a part of a similar ministry, keep listening, as it is a wonderful and vital work of His kingdom. And so I think it's 11 o'clock, and I think I have run out of stories. But I have another story. There was a missionary couple in Pakistan. Their kids were in Murray Christian School with us, Larson. They're now retired up in Canada. Their sons are in Canada. One time, Canada realized that their leadership in areas of nuclear physics and areas of, you know, higher government, their leadership was getting older, and we need to develop a younger leadership preparing to take their place when they retire. And so the government was looking over these possibilities, and they selected Wade Larson to be one. And he went for interview, and he said, here are these five old, duffy old men who are interviewing me. And he thought, this is going nowhere. And so I talked about Murray Christian School. I talked about Pakistan. I talked about this and this. And they said, well, give us three reasons of why we should not invite you into this program. He said, well, one, I don't know French. Secondly, I know nothing about nuclear physics. Third, I know, you know, and four or five weeks later, they asked him to be part of it, and he did. Then as part of that group, he was sent over to India to interface with their people on the same level. They got there, and the Indians hadn't prepared, you know, that great opening. They had a meal together, and then they're going around the room, and each one saying, well, my name is so-and-so, and I do, and I blah, 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 blah. And, you know, it got to him. He said, my name is Wade Larson, and he continued on in Urdu, which is the same as Hindi, except for some vocabulary. And the ambassador is there, and other, and they're saying, who is this that knows perfect Hindi, perfect Urdu? And so he was involved in all of that. Okay, do you have any questions? Yes.
I was just wondering, the Murray School, Christian School, influenced so many people, so many students. Did you have, I mean, the languages? How many languages did you teach in to influence all these people? Because they came from all over, you said.
I know. So we have German students who have very good Murray Christian School English accent. You know, it's right.
So
I would. Oh. So the different language groups. The Germans would look. They said, we want our kids prepared. See, that's a whole different subject. How do you have one school to prepare high school seniors to go back to their home country to be ready to enter university? And the requirements are different, you know, each one. And so they looked at the U.S. curriculum and said, you know, they're not happy. The others are not happy with that. So they looked at the English, A-levels, O-levels, and that doesn't meet the Americans' needs and Australian. So what do we use? They finally settled on doing the Scottish Hires. Scottish Hires, they have six subjects, very similar to the U.S., and it met the needs of each country, the Germans, the Norwegian, you know, the Swedes, etc., Australian, New Zealanders, and so we went with the Scottish Hires.
Did you have translators?
Okay. So each country, they would say, we want our children to be educated in our own language. So they would put we had a German teacher, and then they would have this time slot to teach them German and to teach them maybe German geography, so that they got their home language. We had a Finnish teacher, and you could greet her by saying, Mitä kuuluu? And she taught them, the kids, Finnish, so that they would keep up on that. And then the Norwegians, it's always interesting, not always easy. Part of it is that you're coming, drawing together 12 or so different mission church groups. Theologically, they don't all agree. How do you baptize? When do you baptize? You know? And so we would try to stay on the main doctrine that everyone can agree generally. And when they took them home, they may give them catechism for their own group and, fill in the needs there. Okay, this was in Pakistan. Well, depends on which time you want. They attacked Murray Christian School too. And Murray Christian School, they've written a book, Angels in the Rafters. And all of it was tea time. The staff are outside having tea, the students are doing their thing, and then they all went back in Then the terrorists came. I think there were three of them. We were not there at that time. That was after we had left. And they came, and everyone was inside. They locked the doors, and they killed two or three, and none of the kids were injured. They said, "We're hearing angels in the rafters protecting us." Okay, the other is in Zimbabwe. And these were the Africans, terrorists coming, having been taught, you know, in China. And the school closed at that time. My wife, she is the evangelist. She would stand up. See, she has gray hair. And because of her gray hair, she could teach the men. I'm talking of Pakistan, the Afghan refugees who were in Pakistan. And our mission felt that they're here in Pakistan. What can we do to meet their needs? And they said, "Well, we have English. They need English." And so they started the English as a second language course. And Marlene would have a group of Afghan men charm them. And then she would say, she said, "During the time when we're teaching, we didn't talk about Christianity, but we did. The jokes we told, what we smiled at, how we treated them, it was different than what they saw in the Western movies, because they knew what Americans are like because they've seen our movies." And so as we stand up there, we don't fit the movies. And so we are presenting, we are talking about saying nothing, but doing it. And so Marlene would have a class. She'd say, "I think if we talk, ask that guy and that guy and that guy for tea, that they would come and they may be interested in studying the Bible." And they did. And so she had many, many that were there.
Father, as we close in prayer right now, we are very reminded of the honor we have of having these choice servants with us to tell the story of your church, your kingdom. Let us honor them not as above us, but as fellow brother and sisters in the Lord who inspire us. Be reminded that each one here could tell similar stories in their families, right, to the church, of faithfulness and your faithfulness to us day by day. The tears are near the surface, and we are thankful for that. All of us would say, "Let me lay down my life for Jesus Christ, for his call on us." Let us reckon ourselves even today as having given our lives. And so then day by day, as you're faithful to us and we're faithful to you, you do good things. Let's be reminded that we ought not withhold anything from you, even our breath, as we seek to serve your kingdom together. And Lord, what an honor it is for young and old to come before you and say, "Have your own way, Lord, have your own way." Lord, thank you for your goodness to us. Dismiss us with your blessing. In Jesus' name, amen.